going to guess that most people in this room have spent time in a cubicle or an open office and have some thoughts about how that affected their productivity and sense of well-being. But you both have actual research, and it's the latest cutting-edge thinking about how our work environments shape us. So I want to start here. Can you tell us what is the number one thing the modern office is getting wrong?
Sure. There's lots of things. We only have 15 minutes, so I guess we'll blow through that time. But I mean, from my perspective, it's really the notion of one size fits all, but also that it's static, right? The idea that we can find a sort of optimal workplace for us today, and that it's going to remain that for all time, which of course we all know is not true. Like, your work changes, especially like even week to week, but month to month, year to year, and the fact that the space doesn't evolve with that, and it's hard for us as individuals also to navigate the space to really support the kind of behaviors that we want to have at work, is really challenging and something that I think we need to get a lot better at.
Yeah, and building on top of that, sometimes what we hear at the International Wellbuilding Institute is people have real strong complaints around things like acoustics in their office or things like the temperature in their office, especially when you have many generations of people working alongside one another or both genders working alongside one another. People have really strong complaints when it comes to how the office actually makes them feel throughout the day.
Let's talk a little bit more about open offices, since they seem to be all the rage right now. Now, they do foster co-presence, right? But that's not necessarily the same thing as meaningful interaction. And what I've read, some of your work getting ready for this, is that open offices often produce behaviors that are at odds with what the bosses and designers had expected. How's that?
Well, I think, again, with any office design, an open office is one of these. You have certain behaviors that you want to create when you roll out that design. And with open offices, typically it's viewed as a way to reduce silos, to have people on many different teams interact with each other. And it's not to say that's impossible, but we've seen many cases where that doesn't happen, right? Where when you move people from, whether it's private offices or small team rooms, or from cubicles to open offices today, you can often see teams actually focus a lot more internally and actually reduce interaction between teams, or just even reduce interaction overall, right? And there's a lot of potential reasons for that, but one that we really think is probably likely is that noise carries. You were talking about acoustics earlier, and the idea that if I talk to you, I now interrupt a whole bunch of other people, which I don't want to do. So then some of us wear headphones, or we'll then even remove ourselves from this central area to go somewhere else. And you know, I think there are these generalities, but at the same time, it's really incumbent upon companies, before they make really large changes, to understand what behaviors do we actually want to create, and then for our culture, what environment is going to create that? And for some companies, maybe open offices will work. But for other companies, or for even parts of a company, they could have the opposite effect. And again, this is why I said earlier that I think static offices are an issue, because it's possible to test this, right? It's not rocket science. You can, you know, move part of an office to be like that and see, well, what effect does it have? And if it doesn't work, that's okay, you can change it, right? But I think today people are too focused on doing what like the next trendy thing is and then just assuming it's gonna work out.
Any thoughts on open offices at Well?
Yes, I think that it's really important to give people choice. And if you're transitioning from fixed workstations, assigned desks, to open or unassigned or communal type of work, if you give people autonomy and the ability to do some work at a workstation, some work in a more casual third space, some work in a coffee shop, just recognize that the people who are at the workplace are responsible. They're meeting their deadlines, they're meeting their deliverables. Let them opt into the place where they can get the most productive work done.
Now, one of the things that hampers communication in an open office is this mysterious sounding thing called the invisible fourth wall. Can you tell us more about that and what it does?
Sure. Well, again, think about this. We all have our own workspace, right? And we sort of get into our own world. I might be banging out an email. I might even be on a conference call, right? But I am now again, I'm now in my own world, and it's something that where if you come up to me while I'm in this zone and you tap on my shoulder, I get surprised. I'm like, what's going on, right? And just because we're not aware of the whole environment. And I think that's something that we all experience, but we don't appreciate how really disruptive that can be in an open office environment where you have so many different people in these different modes of work at the same time. And unless there is a really shared cultural understanding about what is and isn't okay, can I interrupt you? Can I engage in conversation with the person next to me? Then it's very hard to set up these barriers that people can navigate really easily.
Now, Angela, your company, the International Well Building Institute, says that buildings can promote wellness and that that can be certified. So how is that? How does a building become well certified?
Thank you. Essentially, what the WELL Building Standard focuses on is a series of strategies that span all different types of concept areas. And these strategies are either design-based, policy-based, or building kind of maintenance and operations. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at things like, how do you construct a space? What types of furniture and furnishings are you bringing in? What type of materials are being used? And how does all of this, together with what an organization can do, what type of HR benefits and policies are being provided to employees on site, how does this ultimately support and improve workplace health, worker productivity, happiness, well-being, engagement?
It sounds like it could be expensive, and we know the Fortune 500s can afford that, but what about a small office with a low budget?
Small office with a low budget, I would recommend really engaging with your workforce. So we're all data driven, and in understanding what workplace wellness and what health means to your actual population who's showing up every day will help you identify some of the right solutions. It can be things as easy as having a mindful eating space, because we know that the research shows when you eat in front of your computer, you're more likely to overeat and report being less satisfied with your meal. So take 10 minutes, go eat with someone else,
so interact. There's data to say I should go work with my coworker.
There's data that suggests it's a good idea to leave your desk. So whether it's finding a lunch buddy or taking a walk, those are really low cost interventions. You have to eat. So
yes.
Find a better way to do it.
That's great. I just want to remind the audience that we'll be coming for your questions in just a moment, so type them into Slido. Ben, your company, you take information from other companies and analyze how people interact with each other.
Yeah.
And you get that information from sensors that are in chairs, on the floor, in mm-hmm. badges, mm-hmm. and sometimes from monitoring online communications. Mm-hmm. We're going to get to the privacy concerns in just a moment, but but first, what has been the most surprising takeaway that you've learned from these sensors?
Yeah, and so, because it's important, we have data on the physical world, but also data on how we communicate digitally, right? So email, chat, that sort of thing, right? And so it's really this holistic understanding of how work happens. And there's lots of different things we've learned from that. Again, originally, before I looked at this data, I actually didn't think that the workplace mattered, if I'm being honest, right? I assumed, hey, I can email anyone anytime. Who cares where I sit? Well, it turns out that actually drives the vast majority of communication. If I sit next to you, I will even chat a lot with you online, which doesn't seem to make sense. But I think with some further reflection, does seem to make sense because, yeah, I can technologically email anybody, but you don't, right? You email the people you know. Mm-hmm. Probably the most surprising result we found, though, is actually getting back to lunch. The size of lunch tables really matters, right? That what we've seen at many, many companies is that when you get larger lunch tables, you can get up to like about 12 people, you actually create more interaction across different teams than if they're smaller, right? It seems weird, but the idea that you're probably not going to go to lunch with 11 other people, right? Maybe two or three other people, but you sit down at a table, and if a couple other groups sit there, you're probably going to talk a little bit to them. And that just makes it more likely that later in the week, you'll go back to those people and actually form a relationship. And again, I think it's fascinating because how many CEOs are agonizing about the size of lunch tables?
Right.
But actually, things like that have a massive impact on how people collaborate.
Well, let's talk about the privacy. The people being monitored, do they know that they're being monitored?
Yeah, so there's a couple things here. So first, we don't collect data at the individual level, so there's no names or email addresses or things like that. There's no content that we collect. Again, I'll preface all this by saying there absolutely should be regulation around what we do. Like, these are things that we don't do, and we actually have opt-in with all of our When we roll out new data collection technologies, we give each person a consent form. You can even find ours on our website that says what we will and won't do with the data. We sign that, our customers sign it, our individuals sign it. Again, you got to do a lot of work to make sure that it's actually opt-in. Like if I see a new sensor, right, making sure that you have fake sensors available so that even your boss can't know you're participating mm-hmm. is a big deal. But again, I think this data is so powerful in that we can start to understand what behaviors predict performance, retention, that sort of thing. But making sure that people have the ability to opt in, making sure that companies don't have the ability to really look at that kind of data at a millisecond level, I think is something that even in Europe needs additional regulation. And we think here as well, we really need to get started on that.
Even if someone opts in, wouldn't yeah. just the mere fact of being watched change behavior?
Yeah, so there's the Hawthorne effect that probably a number of people are familiar with, where just by observing you, you change your behavior. I think for things like email and chat, it's more understood that companies can look at that. At the same time, when it comes to sensor data, something at least going back to our research during our PhDs, you see that the first about 2 days that people are using new sensors, they tend to change your behavior a little bit. But after that, it looks really normal. And then we've just seen that consistently over time.
Great. Well, I'm going to take this audience question. I think, Angela, this is for you. Are you thinking about the effects of or the lack of sufficient light in the modern work environment? Light affects sleep and well-being.
It absolutely does. And yes, that is one of our 10 concept areas of the well-building standard. And specifically around light, we prioritize aligning to the circadian rhythm. So knowing that people are most focused and most alert and productive in the morning, and then having tunable, dimmable lights that adjust as the sun goes up and down to keep people on that healthier sleep-wake cycle and enable them to be more productive in the workplace.
Really, and another really important one you said was air.
Air, yes. I mean, they're all, we've got air quality considerations to promote and improve the health of the air, water quality, so we're cleaning the water and promoting its visibility in the workplace so that people will be more hydrated throughout the day. The nourishment concept that looks at mindful eating and the types of food that are being provided on site. The acoustical considerations, the thermal comfort considerations, healthy materials that are being used on site, movement concepts to get people up and active, and then things like the mind and community concept that look at HR policies, benefits, mm-hmm. And different strategies that align with traditional workplace wellness solutions.
Great. Okay, here's one more from the audience. Does the data suggest anything about the efficiency of the traditional 9-to-5 workday and the 5-day work week?
Well, I certainly think that the data is pretty clear that co-presence with your coworkers, being physically present with them, is valuable. But I do think there's a question about whether that has to be 9-to-5, and actually the data isn't clear that it has to be those 8 hours. There's got to be a period of time where we're in the same place. And it's mostly because, again, as I mentioned earlier, if I sit near you, I talk a lot with you, which, again, makes sense. But that is arguably the most powerful management tool the companies have to drive collaboration. And so that does matter. In a similar way, working 4 or 5 days a week, again, it's somewhat arbitrary, right? Like it's a historical aberration, actually a 5-day work week. It used to be much more than that, right? And at the same time, it's really just getting back to this co-presence idea, right? There's a certain amount of time in any given week that we should probably be working closely with each other. And how long that should be, should it be 5 days, should it be 4 days, should it be 3 days, I think depends on the type of work that you do and really just the needs that your whole team has.
Building off of that, one of our well-certified projects or well-certified clients, Microsoft, actually released a report recently about transitioning to a 4-day work week. And they basically identified that there's a lot of wasted time in meetings. So they truncated their meetings, captured all of that additional time, and actually gave people a whole day back to their lives. Wow. And we're still collecting data. They're still collecting data on it to see the long-term effects. But I think that flexibility is key, giving people autonomy and believing in the work that they're doing and letting them opt into the right environment.
So along those lines, say I work for a small company and it's a horrible floor plan and the bosses don't want to spend any money on design. What can I do as an individual employee to make my space feel a little happier, healthier?
Right.
Not for names here either, okay.
More productive.
You know, you can do things like incorporating more co-working with colleagues, so taking walks, eating away from your desk, you can bring plants in, bringing water elements in, they'll have sort of calming effects on just your mental health at work. But when it comes to physical health, I've done things in my tiny little New York apartment, like introducing air filters that are pretty cost effective, or filtering the water, just to ensure that everything that I can control in terms of what I'm putting into my body is the best solution for me.
Ben, any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I guess one of the key things for me is that for the vast majority of us, we like to think of performance or what we output as how many reports I bang out or emails that I write, where even in small companies, it's much more about really helping the entire team, the entire organization be better, right? And so thinking about, again, eating lunch with a coworker that's actually part of your job, I would argue, right? And making sure that you're taking time for that, right? Making sure that you're prioritizing really building those relationships, the people you work with. Again, it doesn't seem like work, and in small organizations it can be hard because you've got so many constraints, like your time is literally money, right? But making some time for that mm-hmm. is going to make it a better workplace, but also probably make the entire team more productive.
Ben, Angela, thank you very much.
Thank you.